And I can't wait for all of you guys to hear it too. Yeah. Please put your hands together for Daniel. He's a part-time lion tamer.
By the time I was diagnosed with HIV in 1987, I was already well on my way down a spiritual path. I was a very proud carrying card member of what is called the New Age movement. Lovely. And if you look closely, you'll discover that there's actually nothing new about it. It's all very ancient material that's been rediscovered and relooked at for healing and health in a modern world. Well, what I knew about AIDS could fill a thimble, but I knew one thing. If the disease didn't get me, then the medication in 1990 would have. I'm serious. I watched so many beautiful young men start to take AZT. And just a few months later, 6 months, 9 months, sometimes a year, they'd end up in a bed like a fetus. They always looked like that right before they went to meet their maker. And I remember the first time I looked down at that and I said, that is not going to happen to me. It is not an option. So I had to get a healer. Well, I was in Los Angeles, Hollywood. Everybody's got a healer. Or a massage therapist, you know, whatever the case. She was great. Her name was Amy, and she'd lie me on the table every week, and she'd sort of puff me up energetically, and I sort of had a spiritual, energetic immune system that I was running on during those days. And one day, I was lying on the table, and I felt there was all of a sudden a crowd in the room, and I opened my eyes, and I couldn't believe what I saw. It was like a group of ancestors surrounding me, all looking like characters from the cast of The Waltons. And Amy saw the same thing, and she goes, well, why don't you ask them and find out what it is that they want from you? And so I did. And they said, go home. Make peace with your father. Fuck me. Things with my father were extraordinarily complicated. Number one, he was very, very homophobic. I thought he hated me because I was a fag. And I mean, let's be honest here. I grew up in the 60s. Had I told my mother and father that I was attracted to other little boys, I could have been lobotomized. Serious. And then the other thing, I happened to look exactly like his father, whom he killed in a hunting accident when he was 15 years old. I swear to God, Buck LaForce. You look at a picture of him and you look at me and it looks like me in period clothes like the Waltons. And I had sent him a letter telling him that I was HIV positive a few months before. I had told my mother almost a year earlier, but it was a long time for me getting around to tell my dad. And I had sent this letter to him explaining what was going on. And how he reacted was he took that letter and went to his mother, Grandma Rennie, up at the Lake of the Ozarks. And she said, Melvin, honey, don't worry. He's just a carrier. What the fuck is that? But you know what? When I think about it honestly, maybe she knew something that I didn't know. Because look at me. Here I am today. It's 2014. Yeah. Something's working. Yeah. So I found myself in Arkansas in September, and it was hot as hell, as my mother would say. I was decked out in my California Day Glow shorts and a wife beater t-shirt. My hair was pulled back in the perfect mullet. And we were chopping vegetables because, you know, I was turning kind of vegetarian, and Mom made sure we had a lot of fresh Arkansas vegetables to have in a big salad. So we were there, chop, 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 chop. I'm looking like the original psychedelic love child. And chop, 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 and chop, 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 and we're laughing and kidding back and forth. And my dad finally comes in the front door. He hasn't seen me yet. He hasn't seen me yet. He walks into the kitchen, and we're going chop, 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 and the knife hits my finger. And the drop of blood goes down and it drops on the cucumber. And I looked up at my mom and dad and I said, does anybody want AIDS? I was fucking horrified that I had said that. But you know what? When I think about it today, it was the absolute truth. I was wondering, if I have HIV, are you gonna love me? If I die of AIDS, are you gonna love me? Dinner was on completely neutral ground. Very neutral. We talked about television, which at the time meant Twin Peaks. And he told me about a new country and western singer that he had discovered that he thought was just absolutely freaking fantastic. He said this guy ran all over the stage. He was like a rock star, and he wrote a lot of his own music. And I reminded him of him, and his name was Garth Brooks. And I was like, oh, wow, cool, really. Garth Brooks, country star. Yeah, really, me, country music, I don't think so. Yeah, really. And that night that my brother and I went to the movies, and when we got back, my father was where he always was between dinner and sleep, lying on the sofa watching the television set. And at this time, it was Arsenio Hall, and we walked in and we said goodnight, and I went to bed, and oh my God, it was fucking awful. I could hardly sleep. I was having a major anxiety attack. I was thinking, how are we ever gonna talk about this? How are we gonna deal with this? Why did my fucking grandmother say what she said to him? And, you know, on and on and on and on. Finally, I wake up and it's Saturday morning. Mom's gone. She's doing the grocery shopping as she always does on Saturday mornings. And my father, he was gonna swing by work. And then it was going to be his first day on Jenny Craig, so he was going to Jenny Craig. He was dealing with the weight issue as he had been most of his life. And so it was my brother and I at home alone. Now, he was 16, and I was 26, so he's 10 years younger than I was. But remember, I'm wearing the day clothes shorts, and I got the long hair, so we both look like kids. The doorbell rings, and I go to answer the door, and I can't believe what I'm looking at. There's an Arkansas state policeman standing there, smoky bear hat, the whole nine yards. And I was like, yes. And he said, son, is your mother home? And I said, no. What do you need? And she goes, well, I need to stay here and I need to tell your mother something. I said, no, you need to tell me whatever it is you need to say right here and right now. And he did. He told me my father had been killed by someone driving down the wrong side of the freeway, looking to commit suicide, they believed, in 70 feet of flame. I looked at the officer and I said, sir, I said, you are gonna leave now, and I am gonna be the one that tells my mother this. I do not want her having that picture of you in her mind. My father had been a highway patrolman when I was a little boy. Highway safety was his freaking life. I closed the door. I stood there for a second and it hit me. Oh my God, he fucking blew up. Let me tell you something. There is nothing that prepares you for the kind of grief that hits you when a loved one gets ripped from your life out of an act of violence. I looked at my brother and he looked at me and we fell on top of each other in the kitchen. Grief was just coming on us like these waves. It was like a juggernaut of pain and anguish just over and over and over again. And we were crying and the snot was dripping and we're pounding our fist on the floor and I'm banging my head up against the wall at one time. And I mean, it was like the past and the future were coming colliding together in this awful, horrifying present. I looked in the kitchen and I saw my father punch me across the floor the way he did when I was 17 years old. I looked in the dining room and I remembered that stupid wild duck he brought for us to eat, and he broke his teeth on the fucking buckshot. And then I thought, oh my God, this is my daddy who took me to see The Sound of Music when I was 3 years old and opened me up to a world of wonder and magic. Then my brother heaves up all of a sudden and he says, I guess Dad didn't want to go on that goddamn diet anyway. And we fell over in the floor laughing in a heap. By the time my poor mother came home and I was on my knees in front of her, it was as if the bare fist of God had come down and punched her right in the gut. And she sat there and said, no, 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 over and over and over again. And the waves hit, and the people came. And this dude comes up to me, I don't know who the fuck this guy is. And he comes up to me and he says, are you Danny? Are you Danny LaForce? And I said, well, yeah. And he goes, well, I want to talk to you for a minute. I said, all right. And he said, heard what happened this morning, and I wanted to come and tell you just how much your father loved you. He talked about you every day. He was blown away by the things that you could do in front of people. He didn't understand how you could do what it is that you do. Because of that, he couldn't communicate to me. He didn't know how to talk to me. He was my freaking biggest fan. I pulled away from this guy and I went outside in the yard and I cried and I said, oh God, Dad, what the fuck? What do you want me to know? Talk to me, talk to me. What do you? And he just kept saying, Dan. I'm like, what are you talking about? I don't understand. Oddly, a few months later, I got the accident reports and I found something rather astonishing. Yes! This guy was going to commit suicide. He had prepared for it, and he was on some sort of a psychiatric medication that made him do what he did. And there was a woman traveling alongside my father in an SUV with a group of children. And my father pulled up in front of her to take the hit. So in that moment, an act of astonishing courage? I don't know. Perhaps. A couple of weeks after the funerals were over, I flew back to Hollywood, sitting in my chair, with the earbuds in my ear, and I was gonna relax, figure out how I was gonna do the rest of my life. His music came on, but first it was the sound of thunder clapping in the distance, you know, and then it was this country singer. He was singing, and it was Garth Brooks. The thunder rolls. The thunder rolls, and the lightning strikes. Another love goes cold on a sleepless night. And the storm blows on out of control. Deep in her heart, the thunder rolls. And in that moment, all that hatred, all that fear between he and I was dissolved. Forgiveness.